for those great opening remarks. Today we will have several leading experts in multiple disciplines. One of them is Dr. Krassen Stanchev. That not good. He is board chairman, founder, and former executive director of the Institute for Market Economics, the first Bulgarian free market think tank. He was also involved in initiatives related to market-oriented and democratic reforms in the Balkans. His topic for today is liberty. What drives people in and out of the EU? Please join me in welcoming Mr. Stanchev.
Thank you. I will be speaking out of noise. I had a great idea to prepare a presentation, but we forgot the luggage in Ukraine. So, almost arriving in Bosnia last night, we had to drive back to Ukraine and arrived today in the morning like 5 o'clock. So, I failed to prepare my presentation. My topic comes from two recent facts. So, in Ukraine, you had the young people, people from the West, people from the East, from Kiev itself, you know, pouring down the streets and requiring, you know, President Yanukovych to sign the free trade agreement with the European Union. The free trade agreement of all Ukraine, and not only Ukraine, but Georgia, Moldova, whatever, is in a sense a cost transfer, you know, from the Europeans on the neighbors in terms of costs of trade. So in order to trade with the European Union, you should basically finance, you know, what the European Union is consuming. So, but nobody paid attention to this. So basically many experts were explaining, you know, what the free trade agreement with all these eastern neighbors in fact means, but the public actually didn't pay any attention. So it's obvious that Ukrainians had an idea, and this idea was to be closer to the European Union. So the second fact of recent years and days is the referendum in Scotland. So the Scots actually had a problem with the United Kingdom. They believe that the United Kingdom is rent-seeking them. It's free riding on their natural resources, and that they would be doing better if they're not part of the United Kingdom and not part of the tradition which is there since the beginning of the 18th century. Because there was a story in the 18th century, in the 18th century, when the Scots actually decided to be part of the Britain. So these two facts show that there is something which basically drives people in and out of the EU. And I will try to explain what this is about, going into some sort of history. So I think the major reason for all the so-called new members, including Bosnia, including all ex-Yugoslav countries. Davor is here, he will be speaking about Croatia. So what was important at the beginning, and it is still to some extent important, not only for us, but also for Ukrainians, not only for Ukrainians, but for the Moldovans, you know, for Albanians, or for Georgians, this is the symbolism of the Union. Typically, when we were in a position to negotiate with the Union some sort of formal membership, we were calculating the costs and benefits. So, the problem here is that you see no exact measures. So in fact, if there is a benefit, it comes before the membership into the Union. So if there is a benefit, for example, in investment, in all of our countries, these benefits in investment came in a period of 10 to they started coming from say 10 years before the formal membership until say 5 years before the formal membership. So some of the countries, including, you know, such a whatever bad example of a functioning market economy as Bulgaria in the 90s. So Bulgaria, on the eve of the formal membership, become a global leader in foreign investment. Global leader in foreign investment meant that for about 3 years, Bulgaria had foreign investment equal to 30% of GDP. It is a world record since the United Nations UNCTAD started calculating foreign investment like 20 years ago. So, what was the driving force? The driving force was the belief of the people, West and East, that the country is getting into some sort of normality. That's all. So there will be a rule of law, there will be a freedom of movement, of capital, goods, and individuals. So, and that's it. Nothing more was needed. So what was the second reason to calculate something was the so-called subsidies, the transfers from the European Union. I will talk about subsidies later, but the problem with the subsidies from the European Union is that they never come. So it's impossible. And typically, the cost of the transfers, I will explain it, are higher than the benefits of the transfers. So, but when political parties were propagating, you know, the membership of the European Union, they were sort of saying, you know, please, the European Union, yeah, the German taxpayers, you know, we will take some cash from them and we will do the rocks or whatever. We will bring or we will take bits of Sarajevo to the European Union on the European taxpayers' expense or German taxpayers' expense. So none of this ever mattered. So at the beginning of the 90s, immediately after 89, what was important was to close the page of previous history. That was the driving force. I was then in politics, and I know most of the reformers, from Václav and Balcerovic to those whom you don't know, you know, in Bulgaria, for example. So there was no single person to believe in the European economic community as a source of transferring investments or cash. The idea was very simple. The idea was that we will become part again, we will restore our position as a part of the civilized world. For this reason, most of the parties, political parties, which were leading the reforms at the beginning of the 90s, had chosen the blue card. So, not just because it was, I mean, opposite to red, and red was communism. The blue was the color of the European Union. So, we were wearing blue, you know, in the rallies of the 89, you know, we were wearing blue, you know, in our political party logos and that sort of stuff. So, what was also important at the beginning of the 90s is that there was no blueprint. So nobody wanted to sell a new society, create a new human being, like the communists did in the beginning of the 20th century. So the idea, if you read Havel, the idea is to go back to normality. The idea is to become a normal country, nothing more, to be like everybody else. So, in a sense, the revolutions of 89, and it is true for all the countries, it is true for Bosnia, it is true for the post-Soviet Union countries, so which came into the play, you know, rather later than soon, and for ex-Yugoslavian folks, you know, it was the similar case. So everybody wanted to be back to normality. That's it. Nothing more, nothing less. So if you read now the papers, I mean, I spent some time advising the Montenegrin parliament, you know, how they implement the European Union law. It's nonsense what they were speaking about the European Union. They were speaking about the subsidies, they were speaking about good regulations in the European Union. This is not the case. So this does not matter. If it matters, it matters to the extent that everybody believes there is a rule of law which is applicable from country to country, and this rule of law allows for the freedom of movement of people, goods, capital, services, and so on and so forth. So, why the new member states were successful? This is not because we were so clever. So, of course, I'm clever, Balzrovich is clever, Basitlos clever. So, we were successful because we didn't have a choice. But going into the into the free market and into the individual liberty for very simple reason. So, at the first day of after the free elections, for example, after the first three elections after World War II, none of our countries had the luxury of sort of sizable fiscal reserves. So some of the countries were on the verge of default, actually all of them. Some of the countries defaulted. Bulgaria and Poland defaulted. And they defaulted heavily. I will make a comparison between Bulgarian default, the Polish default, and the Greek default. Because there are some commonalities. So, but nobody had the cash, you know, to do any social policy. Nobody had the cash for central planning even in the area of environment. So the industries were not only